Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I've got a difficult topic to discuss with you today, and that is what historical evidence exists for the Exodus. I get asked about this a lot, and so let's spend a few minutes going over the sources just to understand, you know, what do we know about the Exodus that's not described in the Bible itself. So, some caveats. First of all, the Bible has historical data in it, but for the most part, it's not a book of history. Its goal, as stated explicitly in the Bible itself, is to instill religious values. Not historical awareness, but religious values. Have a look, just for example, at Deuteronomy 10, where it says, "Vata Yisrael, ma Hashem Elokecha shoel mimach." Now, Israel, what does God want from you? Right, it's a really good question. I'd like to know the answer to that. Ki im liyira es Hashem Elokecha lalechus b'kod rachav ulahava oso. You know, God wants us to revere God, to walk in divine paths, to love and serve God with all our heart and soul. And it continues in verse 13, Lishmor etz mitzvos Hashem v'eschuchosav, asher anochi mitzavka hayom latov lach. To guard the mitzvos of Hashem, right? Mitzvah, kind of like a good deed, sort of a commandment, literally. And his decrees, God's decrees, that I, Moses is speaking here, command to you today. That's what the Bible is all about, right? Now, it's important to note that the Bible is not a single author document, right? It's not really a book. It's a library, many, multiple authors, most of whom have named books, Jeremiah, Isaiah, and so on. And sometimes, because of their multiple authors, you'll see ideas expressed in different ways. Like, for example, in Micha, the sixth chapter, you'll see that there's a different statement of what God wants from this. What does the Lord require of thee? Only to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God. So is that the same thing as in Deuteronomy? Are they different ways of expressing it? Are they different things? So it's still a very confusing kind of thing. But that's the point of the book. It's not to give historical information. It is to instill religious values. Some of the books, it's true, are very historical in nature and written by extremely talented historians, books of Samuel, Kings, and Chronicles, for example. But in some areas, the books are strangely ahistorical, and that's what we're looking at today. The book of Exodus gives us a tremendous amount of information, drama, very motivational to see the saga of Moses and the Hebrews as they're leaving Egypt and struggling with freedom and receiving the Torah and things like that. But historically, I mean, we don't even know the name of the Pharaoh involved in the whole story. There's a question, famous question asked in the Talmud, was this the same Pharaoh as under Joseph? Or is it a different Pharaoh? That would make sense why, you know, the first Pharaoh seems so well inclined towards Joseph. Now, this one is not so nice. And on the other hand, maybe it's the same Pharaoh and he changed his mind, changed his opinion. So we don't know when it happened from the name of the Pharaoh. We do have a way to calculate the dates that was determined by Rabbi Yossi ben Chalafta, but that system was devised about 1,500 years later, and it was based on calculations of where the Bible actually does give us dates, which is sparse and few between, and there are gaps, and it's very confusing to figure out the timeline. But in Rabbi Yossi ben Chalafta's book, known as Seder Olam Rabbah, he places the Exodus in the year 2448 Anno Mundi, meaning from creation. This is where we get the year that we're currently enjoying. 5783 is the Jewish year right now. But how does that translate into the Gregorian calendar? It would be right around the late 14th century before the Common Era. That date actually is not too bad when we look at the very first piece of non-biblical evidence that talks about the Jewish people, and that is the famous Merneptah stele, which was erected about 100 years after the Exodus, which, if we're following the biblical narrative, by this point, the Hebrews had left Egypt, had done their wandering in the Sinai Desert, and had crossed into the land of Israel under Joshua, had a few wars with the local peoples, had a few wars with each other. And then, according to this stele, this monolithic structure that was a memorial document for this Pharaoh Merneptah, they were conquered by the Egyptians. Here's the Merneptah Stela in situ in the museum, and you can see, because there's a person next to it, how massive this thing is. It's basically a kind of like a picture on the top, and then underneath is a long list of Pharaoh Merneptah's amazing conquests, right, which was erected to praise this pharaoh. And he goes about describing how he conquered this territory and beat this army and destroyed this people. And then near the bottom, but geographically consistent with the area of the land of Israel, specifically the hill country of what would later be called Judea, there's this phrase here: Israel is wasted, its seed is no more. Some historians have argued that this term, his seed, meaning Israel's seed, is referring to like the grain or maybe a standing field of wheat or something like that. But it seems out of place for Pharaoh Merneptah to come up to the land of Israel and then to specifically proclaim that, oh, I burned down their field. Doesn't seem like really a pharaonic kind of thing to do. More likely, and most historians have this consensus, that the term his seed really means, like it does in modern Hebrew, zera, means his offspring. Meaning Pharaoh Merneptah, like so many anti-Semites after him, prematurely declared the destruction of the Jewish people in this genocidal document. And so we don't have to worry about the Jews anymore because I, Pharaoh Merneptah, have taken care of them. It's actually kind of funny because when you look at pictures of, you know, cute Jewish children today, they look like they're doing pretty well. Pharaoh Merneptah, on the other hand, they actually discovered his mummy. He does not look so good. I'm just saying. So the dating of the Exodus seems to fit with the extra-biblical evidence that we have so far, this one stele, but it doesn't say anything about how Israel got to be there and what was Israel exactly. Is that referring to a land or a place or a people or what? We don't really know. You will from time to time find that highly energized Bible enthusiasts. I use that term with some irony because the term enthusiasm in Greek means to have God within you. Well, like, accept rather credulously some rather bizarre, extreme, and totally unreliable claims, such as, for example, the argument that submerged Egyptian chariot wheels were discovered in the Red Sea. We're not even sure exactly where the Jews were to have made that great crossing. The Hebrew term used in the Bible is not Red Sea, but Sea of Reeds, Yam Suf, which seems to indicate, you know, not so much like a massive sea like in Cecil B. DeMille's Ten Commandments, but more like, a very difficult to traverse wetland, like a large marsh or something. We don't really know. We haven't found archaeological evidence of the supposedly massive number of Jews who left Goshen and made their way into the Sinai Peninsula for 40 years. Now, it's not hard to imagine that whatever they left behind simply would have been lost. It was impossible back then to get any decent Asian takeout, so it's not like they're going to be leaving a landfill's worth of, you know, takeout containers. But, these are things that we simply do not have historically. So in other words, the major source that is preserved of the Exodus is the description itself that exists in the Hebrew Bible. Even the location of Mount Sinai is unknown, although there is one specifically mountain that according to Arabic and Christian tradition, is Mount Sinai itself. Here you can see a dramatic picture of it. It's known as Tur Sinai or Jabal Musa, although there's no real indication to suggest that this is exactly the same mountain described in the Bible. The reasons for the absence of evidence is not surprising. The environment is not ideal for preserving archaeological sites. Goshen, for example, which is located in the eastern delta of the Nile, is very infamous for its soft soil and for the regular flooding, the silt coming in, and you know it's very hard to preserve any material there. And that is incidentally something which is corroborated by the Mishnah itself. But it is interesting to note that the story of the Exodus was widely known in the ancient Near East. For example, we have the writings quoted later of the Egyptian priest Manetho from the early 3rd century before the Common Era, who seems to be quite conversant with the Jewish tradition of the Exodus, although he tells it in a very different way, in which, you know, it's not like a miraculous divine event where the Jews are saved and taken as a nation of slaves out of one land and moved to another. Rather, they were driven out, according to his version of it, which of course leads us to another somewhat irritating habit of the ancient Egyptians to remove or rewrite history when it did not suit the memory that they wanted to preserve. We see this very clearly, for example, with the reign of Hatshepsut, who was one of the most important pharaohs and also a female pharaoh who was a great builder and very active in her long reign and very, very powerful, sometimes depicted as a woman, as you see in this particular statue, and other times depicted as a male with a false beard growing out of her chin. And for reasons which are unknown, at some point later in time, all of Hatshepsut's memory was under attack by a later dynasty. Perhaps it had to do something with sibling rivalry, perhaps it had to do something with the fact that she was a woman, but her reign is, you know, wiped out of much of the archaeological record and only discovered in a few places and allow historians to put together what she actually did during her lifetime. So the Egyptians, you know, they would have no problem simply saying, let's skip that whole chapter of the Hebrew slaves and how they got out of here, because it'd be intrinsically humiliating. Okay, so that's all sort of like negatives and caveats and things like that. What exactly do we have that would suggest that this belief is credible? So, for example, one of the most fascinating areas is linguistic evidence. When you look at the Book of Exodus, there are quite a few technical Egyptian words that are inserted in the text, like, for example, the name for the sorcerers, Khartoumim, which appear to be really specifically identified with that particular time and place and society. It doesn't seem to be words that were widely used elsewhere, and they locate the text, as it were, within the court hierarchy specifically. Also, titles like the name that Joseph gets at the peak of his power, Tzafnat Paneach, which is a very unusual, not a Hebrew word, but borrowed from Egyptian lore and brought into the tradition. Some fascinating things like that. They're internal literary evidence that points to the place and time of Exodus. Another example, the great scholar Dr. Kenneth Kitchen did a tremendous amount of research on the price of slaves in the ancient Near East over a period of hundreds of years and was able to track the ups and downs of the slave market. And it happens that the sale of Joseph into slavery, which of course precedes the Exodus, is exactly the same price that would make sense according to the ebb and flow of the economic value of slaves in the market at the time. So it's like an ironic, not, I don't want to say coincidence in the sense like it's like happenstance, but it seems to be a distinct parallel. So we have some fascinating kinds of literary evidence. I would strongly recommend, by the way, here's one of my favorite copies of Exodus. It's a nice, big, heavy book. This is the Koran Tanakh of the Land of Israel, which is an extremely beautifully well-illustrated scholarly volume that has lots of really interesting data on what's Egyptian that appears in the Hebrew text and so on. And I strongly urge you to have a look at it if these kinds of things interest you. We also have historical data of patterns of migrations that are consistent with the depiction in the Book of Exodus. For example, this period depiction that shows you the Hyksos, who were Western Semites, migrating into the land of Egypt, entirely consistent with the story of the Hebrews in Exodus. Some historians have even argued that the Hyksos should somehow be identified with the Hebrews. We also have this amazing bit of papyrus that's actually directions on brick making for the period, which correspond precisely to the data that we have in Exodus. So they're making bricks with the same kind of technology at that time as described in these documents. And here's like an example that I find especially powerful and appealing. In the region of a place called Kantir, which is precisely in the eastern delta of the Nile, which is associated with Goshen, they discovered some mud pits recently, near 2016. And they are like, wow, straight out of Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments. And here's one photograph that I find especially fascinating and very moving. They actually found some frozen child's footprints in the dried mud itself. Like, wow, We don't know which child left these footprints. But it's amazing to look at this and to read the description of the book of Exodus of the horrible servitude that the Hebrews were forced to engage in, and to imagine, what if this was the footprint of a Hebrew child? Okay, now none of this is absolutely hard, indisputable historical evidence. Nothing like that has been discovered, at least not yet. We do have some interesting philosophical arguments, which I won't go into here, but you can look, for example, at Rabbi Yehuda Alevi and the Kuzari. But ultimately, the belief in the description of Yetzias Mitzrayim, the exodus from Egypt, which is such a core element in Jewish civilization, is ultimately a matter of faith. And so ironically, we have to return to where we started, that the Exodus narrative in the Bible does not provide us with an account that we can precisely, definitively prove with some kind of extra-biblical evidence. We can find lots of really interesting sort of parallel bits of information that support the narrative, and that's fascinating. But ultimately, it requires faith. And faith can only exist in a universe where doubt is also credible. So what I take away from all of this, after spending so much time thinking about the history of this unusual people, is that the greatest argument for the validity of the Exodus is not going to be found necessarily in, you know, some archaeological discovery. What I find most powerful personally, and perhaps this will be useful for you if you're celebrating a Passover Seder in a couple of weeks, that the Jewish people, this remarkable, unusual, creative, sometimes problematic people, have seen so many hundreds of civilizations rise and fall. We've seen so many pharaohs, one after another, many of them, like Merneptah, seeking to destroy us. And nevertheless, here we are, over 3,000 years later, still talking about the meaning of the Exodus, what it has to say about us as a people and about our relationship to larger human civilization, what it says about core values of freedom and dignity. The fact that we're still having the same conversation that no doubt Maimonides had around his table, that Rabbi Akiva had around his table, that's something that to me is far more powerful than any other bit of archaeological data. I hope you found this video useful, and as the tradition goes, I wish you a Chag Kasher V'Sameach, a joyous and kosher holiday. Thank you very much for listening.